Howdy. As they said, in 2018, that summer, my oldest son decided that I needed to travel with him on the Camino. And he chose a route. If you're familiar with it, he chose a route. He chose the northern route. If you're not familiar with it, I'm going to spend a little bit of time getting you maybe a little more information. So he chose a route that traveled from Irun, Spain, right on the border of France, all the way to Santiago de Compostela. And this was 525 miles that he hiked. And he invited me to go along with him, but I didn't have that much time. And so I said, I will go with you, but I'll only do half. And so I started with him in Irun, and I went to Oviedo, where we met his twin sister, and she finished the hike with him. I did 270 miles, and when you have two guys hiking along, I spent a lot of time in my head, okay? There wasn't a lot of chatter on the trail. And so I began to reflect on things, and these are just a few things that I learned on the trail that I wanted to share with you this evening. When we started in Irun, there was a sign. We stayed at hostels that were specific for people on the trail. The people on the Camino, they're called pilgrims or peregrino, and you would stay at an albergue, and that was the hostel for the peregrines. And so there was a sign on the wall in Irun, and it said, "A tourist demands or complains," depending upon your translation, "and a pilgrim says thank you." And I thought about that as I was hiking. I thought, that's a really interesting thing. I hadn't seen that before. And I just sort of began to ponder on this idea as I was traveling down the trail. And so this was a beautiful trail. This it was not the most, you know, if you're familiar with it at all, the Francais is the big trail that is, well-developed. And this is sometimes just a narrow little goat path along the coast. And you're going from village to village, and as you would travel from village to village, you would meet people, and people would wish you Buen Camino. They would say, Buen Camino, and your response was always Buen Camino back to them. And so they're wishing you a good trip, or a good way, as it is. And so it was, as I'm walking, I'm thinking, as I mentioned, my son decided to do this trip. And it was basically before he started medical school. And so he was doing this big thing. And I also recognized that we were sort of going to part company, as far as life goes. And so I'm reflecting and I'm thinking about this and I'm learning these things as I go. And so it was just struck me that this Camino was an allegory for life. And so what I did was the first thing I came up with, the first lesson I learned was to engage. And what was interesting is we stayed in, I think about day two or three, we're in a monastery. Now the Camino originally started out as a Catholic pilgrimage, and it's still that, but it's actually one of the great hikes of Europe. There's several, and this is one of the, the big ones, okay? And I will also say in full disclosure, I'm not Catholic, so I don't have a history. I don't know what this is about. And so we stayed at this monastery, and the monks invited us to attend Vespers. And I'm like, I don't know what that means. And I'm thinking, I'm not going to get anything out of it, because it's going to either be in Spanish or Latin, and I'm not good at either one of those. And so I thought, well, I could easily do my laundry or read a book or something like that. But then part of my brain, the smarter part, said, look, you're in Spain. Monks have invited you to attend Vespers. Attend Vespers. And what was funny was nothing bad happened. And so I attended, and I'm like, that was okay. And actually what it was an icebreaker for me. It got me out of, and listening to the last speaker, she likes to talk and talk. I'm an introvert. After this, I'm going to have to go sit quietly somewhere for a while. And so this broke the ice for me. And so later, the monks came in and they brought soup and they fed. There was about 30 of us in this room. And so they fed us and somebody handed me a ladle. And so I ladled soup. And it was just an amazing experience because English wasn't the primary language. There was Spanish, there was German, there was Russian, there was Japanese, Italian and French, and some English. And so all these people from all these different backgrounds were coming together to experience this journey. And what was interesting is, like, this is a Czech couple. My son is the one in the blue with the hat. And this is a Czech couple that we would meet and, you know, travel with for a while. But because the paths would always sort of diverge from each other, they might want to go somewhere else. And then what would be funny is you would run into them maybe 2 or 3 days later, and it was like you were seeing old friends, even though you just met like 48 hours previously. It's like, well, how have you been? And so it was very interesting, and I feel like if I hadn't taken that initial step to just say, I'm all in, it would have always been just sort of this, oh, hello again type thing, okay? And so the second lesson I learned was to know your signs, and this was a very, very important lesson. When we left the albergue in Irun, there was no fanfare, there was no police cordons, there was no people directing traffic. You just had to look for signs of the Camino. The top sign is the classic seashell, and so basically what happens is the rays of the shell point towards Santiago. So the shell would be in different positions telling you which way to go. On our trail, it was more common to see the yellow arrow. The shells were not as common. And so you had to look for the yellow arrow, and you'd be coming down into a village, and there'd be a fork in the road, and you're having to look for the yellow arrow. And maybe you can appreciate the yellow arrow painted on that middle signpost. And that would be your arrow. That would tell you the direction to go. What was, you know, and sometimes it almost had a sort of a Where's Waldo feel. Where is the arrow? Which way do I need to go? And what was interesting, though, is sometimes somebody would paint an arrow that was taking you the wrong direction. And they were probably just trying to get you to come by their restaurant or their hotel or something like that. But this arrow would not look right. And it was interesting. It would be the wrong color yellow. It would be the wrong dimensions. And you're like, no, that's not a real arrow. And so, you know, this one I saw hiking along the road, you can see the Public Works Department was helping people find their way to Santiago. And what was interesting, though, is if you got off the trail, nothing told you you were off the trail. There was no arrow that said, go back. There was no sign that said, you're lost. You had to just physically go back and say, where was the last time we saw something? Okay. And so it was very important as you're traveling on the way to know what signs you're following and can you trust the signs that you're following? This was a big idea. A big lesson was a pilgrim walks. Okay, and I mentioned the idea that we are pilgrims and we carried credentials with us. And so this is a copy. I brought mine with me just to show you. It's, you know, it's a real thing. It unfolds. It has stamps in it of all the different places I went. And we went to, there was one place where we went, this was an albergue in Santa Cruz de Bazana. And there was a woman there that her name was Nieve, and she was the hostess. Her family lived in one side, her family lived in the side with the flowers, and all the pilgrims stayed in the other side. And she would cook dinner for us. And then she brought us all in, and what was interesting is this type of an albergue was called a donativo, meaning you just donate whatever to pay for it. There's no cost, you just donate whatever. And what was funny was she was so good, you were like happy to donate because she'd give you good food and she provided really great advice. But the thing she told us is, hey, there is a barrier, there's a ravine coming up on the trail. And you can walk back to the highway and take the highway bridge over this ravine, because the ravine is where the river went into the ocean. Or, and she said that would add about 8 miles for the trip. And the ravine, or the bridge over the ravine was a dangerous bridge. It was narrow and cars were going over it. And so she said, that's not a really good idea. There was also a bridge that the train went across. And she said, you cannot walk across that bridge because there's no room for you in a train. She says, but it is acceptable for you to get on the train and pay all of something like 75 euro cents to cross over to the other side and then get off the train. And there was a couple there that were newlyweds, and they're from Germany, and they said, well, does the train go on to the next village? And she said, yes, it does. And he said, well, can't we just take the train to the next village? And she said, no, a pilgrim walks. And the idea is that you have to experience everything on the way. You have to experience the beautiful views. You have to experience the muddy trails. I don't know how many times it was rainy that year, and to slog up a muddy trail over a ridge and then suddenly see the ocean was just amazing. And so we felt like just the struggle through the difficulties and the adversity only enhanced the rest at the end, or the view at the end, or the amazing meal at the end of the trail. And so without that, if we had just ridden a bus from here to there, it wouldn't have been the same experience at all. So her point was, a pilgrim walks, and it was amazingly true. This was another one that I looked at, and I actually thought about, how am I going to phrase this? Because I was thinking about saying, you know, using the word, you know, do good or pay it forward or something like this. But the thing is about this is, this can be done actively or passively. Okay. And so we met this one gentleman at this church. This is St. Peter's in Orinha, Spain. And it was interesting because we had gotten up, my son and I had gotten up early, and we were on the trail because we were trying to get to this really cool albergue that has a great reputation and has a limited space. So we were up early. And so we come up to this church, and it's a beautiful church. And so we decide to detour into it, and there's a gentleman outside, Gunther, and he's right at the little portico there, and he's bathing his dog with a garden hose out front. And so he quickly sees us coming, and he throws open the gates, and he opens everything up, and he provides for us juice and pastries and shows us pictures of the picnics that they've had. And he took us up into the bell tower and explained all the bells and the history of this church. Okay. And when I'm looking out the bell tower, I see other groups see what's going on and turning away from the church and walking on because they don't want to be delayed. But, you know, I brought this, I brought my little shell. Gunther made these for everybody because the shell is the symbol for the Camino when he painted it. And so I just, you know, brought that to show you. This gentleman was intensely passionate about this in his life. And I, you know, thought about it, and I thought, he's probably not paid for this. He decided, I'm going to be up there and welcome the pilgrims as they go by. And so, yeah, we were late to the next albergue. We did get the last two spots, so it turned out well. But what was interesting is there were people there that we had known, that we'd traveled with before, and they were beginning to chide us. They said, oh, you're so slow. We got here so early. You know, we've had a nice meal, and here you are just arriving. And I'm like, but wait. We got to listen to Gunther, and we got to experience his passion. And we got to actually, you know, we didn't do anything for him. He did for us, but we just listened to him. And we blessed him with our time and our attention and our respect. And so for me, that was worth being late. And so that was another lesson is, you know, you can bless people with your attitudes or, you know, with your actions too. And then the last lesson that I learned was to be grateful. And this goes back to that sign in Irun that says, a tourist complains and a pilgrim is grateful. Or thankful. What I actually realized is a pilgrim becomes thankful on the trail. This is Father's Day dinner or lunch. It was lunch. And so to point out just some of the things that you might see there, yes, those are oranges and two different types of bread. The sausage was elk chorizo, okay? And we had, apricots, almonds, and I would say the most aggressive blue cheese that I have ever encountered in my life. It was phenomenal. And because we were here, and we had Father's Day lunch on the beach, and you know, nothing that I had ever encountered before. And there was a couple of Scottish lads, and that is an apt description. Archie and Marseille, they were Scottish lads. Sorry, vet came out there. They were not Labradors. They were lads, okay? And so what they did was they actually tent camped the entire way, 525 miles in a tent every day. They were trying to save their money, okay? And that, to me, when I was that age, would have been phenomenal. I would have done that. I would have thought that was amazing. And so, but instead of being jealous of their Camino, I'm like, that's their Camino. Mine is you know, blue cheese on the beach. And it's not to compare. As soon as we start comparing what we're doing with other people, we lose gratitude. And so that is the one of the biggest lessons, is no matter what, be grateful for what you have. And so as I continued on this trail, like I said, it was just an amazing experience. I have done a fair amount of hiking, but I've never done anything like this. And so this was phenomenal. And you might be thinking, hey, this sounds like something that I would like to do. You know, maybe someday I'll book a ticket and fly into, you know, Barcelona or something like that and get a bus and hike the Camino. Okay, and I would say, yes, please, it's an amazing opportunity. But the other thing that I would also point out, because again, I was in my head and we're talking about an allegory, is you are on your Camino at this point. Wherever you were born was Irún. And are you engaged in your life, or are you just waiting for something to happen? Are you waiting for something to change, or are you actually participating in it? Do you know the signs that you need to follow to get to your destination? Do you know what your destination is? Or have you lost the trail and need to backtrack a bit? Are you walking? Are you purposely going through everything, or are you trying to skip portions of it because they're too hard? And are you a blessing to others around you? And also, are you grateful for what you have? So as they would say in Spain, as you encountered them on the trail, I wish you all buen camino. Thank you.